everyone. Welcome. My name is Philip James, coming to you from the RFAMD podcast. And today's guest is Dr. Dhingra. Dr. Dhingra, welcome.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. You've had 25 years of experience as a thyroid doctor, thyroid surgeon. For those listening or watching, please share a little bit about your background and experience.
My background is one of an ENT or ear, nose, and throat surgeon, and I practice comprehensive otolaryngology, including a surgery of the neck, and that's where the thyroid comes in. And I've been focusing my practice predominantly doing thyroid surgery for the last 10 plus years. And as part of that, I've used the radiofrequency ablation as a tool for managing thyroid disease for the last 5 years or so.
Yeah, Dr. Dhingra, you're one of the early adopters, I would say, in the United States for thyroid ablation. You were one of the first in Massachusetts to adopt ablation, which is fascinating because you're a surgeon and you treat patients with thyroidectomy sometimes. Now you're offering a non-surgical approach to treating patients. And the topic of this interview is what we're seeing is a wave through the United States right now where professionals are adopting thyroid ablation. But you say there might be some dangers to that. But before we get there, I want to know a little bit about something I uncovered in your background, and that is your annual trip to Africa. Why?
Yeah, the annual trip to Africa is to the Rwanda, where the goiters are endemic, and they are largely affecting women population with large goiters. And I volunteer my time to go and teach and perform surgeries on these patients. To give them relief from a highly complicated neck condition.
Amazing. And when you are there, how many patients will you treat?
We typically go for 1 week, and in that 1 week period, we would treat between 25 to 30 patients.
What would these patients do if it wasn't for you or someone like you helping them?
Honestly, nothing. They don't have access to enough surgical expertise to take care of these conditions. They sometimes get voodoo treatments where somebody sticks in thermal energy into the neck with their hot needles to try and ablate these nodules, and that doesn't go anywhere because they go just skin deep and have no effect on the thyroid. We've been doing these surgeries, and we've been training the local physicians how to do it safely.
Wow. Well, that's really fantastic. Amazing work. And makes me think of an interview last week that we had Dr. Juan Pablo Duenas on the podcast, and he was saying his most proud treatment with ablation was a woman that came to his office with a gigantic goiter. And he said, he was amazed that successfully she was relieved of this problem. And I think it's relevant to what we're talking about today, the dangers of how rapid thyroid ablation is being adopted in the United States. But you were saying if a doctor is not skilled, say for ultrasound, this could lead to problems. Before we get there, for those listening or watching, what exactly is thyroid ablation? How does it work?
Thyroid ablation, the most prominent one, the most acceptable one is radio frequency ablation, where radio frequency energy is delivered to the inside of the thyroid nodule through a needle electrode, an electrode which is just size of a large hypodermic needle that we commonly use, something like an 18-gauge needle, and we are able to deliver the thermal energy to the inside of the nodule, and that causes reaction and scar tissue, if you like, to shrink the nodule and thereby give patient the relief from the symptoms.
Where does ultrasound factor into the procedure?
Yeah, so the ultrasound and having expertise in ultrasound is extremely important in this situation, because you're ablating something in the neck which is 2, 3, 4 centimeters in size, And the neck has all these vital structures, including the major artery, the major veins, like the carotid artery, the internal jugular vein. There's a nerve that supplies the vocal cords. All those structures are potentially at risk of injury from the thermal energy that you're delivering. If one is not careful and one does not have a good expertise of how to avoid getting too close to these structures.
Yeah, so in clarify something. Just because a doctor is a thyroid surgeon, does that mean he or she is a good person to do ultrasound?
No, I mean, unless they have experience doing an ultrasound, right? So just because you're a thyroid surgeon doesn't make you a good thyroid ultrasonographer. And just because you can do thyroid ultrasonography doesn't make you a good thyroid surgeon. So one has to, both have to go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. So not everybody who does thyroid surgery has the expertise of doing the ultrasound, right? So, sure. So one has to do both. And in fact, we at our Academy of Otolaryngology had neck surgery, do annual courses, teach and train the young residents and the fellows who are coming out of the programs and who are going to be doing thyroid surgery into how to do ultrasound and ultrasound guided procedures in the neck in a safe fashion. Unfortunately, the incorporation of these techniques and this training is not there in the residency training system itself. So we try and do that extra training by offering courses and which are done through different organizations, including the American Academy, and I'm part of that faculty.
You know, thyroid ablation is getting a lot of good coverage and positive stories about some of these, you know, amazing results. Like I cited Dr. Duenas in Medellin, Colombia, treating a giant goiter. But you were saying there's also some dangers, in particular, when you have a professional who might not be that skilled at ultrasound. Offer additional detail about the danger.
The danger is because of the proximity of these vital structures in the neck to the disease or the nodule that we are treating, and it's not uncommon to have the nodule that you're treating to be half a centimeter or 1 centimeter away from the area which we are ablating. And if the thermal energy dissipates and gets close to any of these structures, like the carotid artery or the recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is not at all uncommon to end up with an injury to these structures. And it is important that the person, before they take on radiofrequency ablation and incorporate that into their practice, that they feel comfortable, that they have done a number of ultrasound guided procedures in the neck, so that they feel comfortable in placement of the needle, which is just a sharp small needle when you're doing a biopsy, but it's much more of a weapon when you're trying to do ablation. Because not only is it a much bigger needle, it also is delivering high energy and thermal power to that structures which are in a small part of the neck.
You know, we were talking earlier and you were saying there's another danger, and that is sometimes doctors are treating thyroid nodules that really don't need treatment. They're too small. In those cases, you say no to the patient. You say, nothing's necessary. In fact, definitely not even ablation. But to the contrary, we're also hearing about cases where some doctors are treating a patient with a very small thyroid nodule. Kind of expand that narrative, that story for us, if you can.
So as far as the treating the small nodule, there are two aspects to it, and I'll differentiate that. When we're talking about a small nodule, which is benign, it's not likely to be causing any symptoms. Once we've done the needle biopsy and we have a good benign result, the risk of malignancy in that nodule is 5% or less. And the most appropriate treatment in that situation is to observe that nodule rather than do any form of intervention. And I consider radiofrequency ablation to be a significant enough intervention with potential significant side effects of major vessel injury and the nerve injury. In fact, the risk of injury is more when you're dealing with a small nodule because you're in a smaller space now. Right. If you're treating a 4-centimeter nodule, which is just next to the nerve or something, and you can give it a cuff of protection of 0.5 centimeter to 1 centimeter of the tissue between a cushion between the nerve and the area being ablated. But if you're ablating a 2-centimeter nodule, you are more likely to be closer to that, to the vital structure in the neck as you're ablating this nodule. So I would warn against doing smaller nodules if they are not causing any symptoms and if they've proven to be benign, they're not likely to cause any cosmetic compromise at about 2 centimeters anyway. So that's one point that I want to make about treating small nodule. Mm-hmm. However, if you're treating a small cancerous nodule, that's a different fish. So you don't want to be treating a 4-centimeter thyroid cancer with radio frequency ablation. But if you got a 1-centimeter focus, or you got a recurrence in the thyroid bed, or you got a small lymph node next to the nerve, if you treat that with an ablation, that there's a role for radio frequency ablation in that situation.
You know, the mission of this podcast, a mission, is to provide patients with the best available information to make the most informed decisions. And with that being said, and after expressing some of these dangers that come with even thyroid ablation, people sometimes think it's a very easy procedure, but it can be dangerous. What do you feel as a whole, especially in the U.S. where there's rapid adoption, where doctors can be following guidelines or standards to make sure the patients are selected properly and given the best treatment without putting them at risk?
Yeah, I think the guidelines are extremely important, and they have to come from, and in fact, they already are guidelines, we don't have at this time any definitive numbers. Like the Koreans, when they adopted the radio frequency ablation, they had a well laid out guidelines where they said, okay, you have to have, I don't have the numbers now, I just off the top of my head, but you know, you have to have done so many thyroid diagnostic thyroid and so many ultrasound guided procedures. You have to go and observe somebody for a certain number of cases, and then you have to have done some certain number of cases under somebody's guidance, and so on and so forth. So well laid out guidelines whereby you try and make it as safe as possible, not just, hey, this is a needle and I know where to put it and I can deliver the energy, because there is there'll be a danger to that. We don't want to be especially when you're adopting a new technology, you don't want pushing the envelope, but being extra cautious so that because then it can go the other way. If we try and overuse the technology, then there's a danger that if we end up with complications or bad outcomes, that we'll be taking two steps back.
And with all the cases that you've treated, what's been the overwhelming response from your patients after receiving thyroid ablation?
on the whole, positive. I warn them that it's not going to be like they're not going to wake up the next day and it'll be gone kind of a thing, which will happen if they had surgical treatment, but it's going to be a slow process. But most of them, when I see them back, say by 3 months' time, have noticed a significant amount of difference in their in the size of the nodule and the symptoms.
Hmm. All right. So, Dr. Dhingra, it's been great to hear this perspective about the dangers of the rapid adoption of thyroid ablation, in particular in the United States, who really is relatively new to thyroid ablation compared to, say, Brazil, Italy, or South Korea. Any final thoughts to share with those listening or watching?
I think it's a wonderful technology. It has to be adopted in a slow manner. It has to be, I would warn against taking it on unless one considers oneself as an expert in performing ultrasounds and ultrasound guided needle biopsies. That I think is the key to doing it successfully.
Okay, I'm a patient in Boston, okay? And you got my interest. I have a thyroid nodule, I want treatment. How do I find you?
Well, you can find me through different resources. You can go to my practice website, which is entspecialist.com. You can go to the RFAMD website. And just Googling me or, the best way is to contact me through my practice.
How far are you from Boston?
20 miles.
And a lot of your patients actually come from out of state. Where are they coming from?
All the surrounding states, all the surrounding New England states. The farthest I've had is from New Jersey, which is 250 miles. And then the other patients have been from Maine, from New Hampshire, from Connecticut, from New York City. I think those are the states we've had patients from.
Mm. Great. Well, listen, it's great to sit down with you today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
And for all those watching and listening, the links to how to contact you will be in the description to the video or the show notes.